Oh, my hope is Amen. You have your Bibles, go to Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2. You get there, let's stand in honor of God's word. Got a pretty serious message this morning, and I ask you to pray for me and just be attentive. We ain't careful, we come to church and we think it's Christmas time and I've heard all the Christmas messages. Well, when you get that kind of attitude, God don't speak to you. You shut the Holy Ghost out. We all need God to speak to us. Amen.
Come on, Richard.
Luke chapter 2, just going to read two verses. Very familiar scripture. Let's look at verse 6 and verse 7. You there, say amen.
Amen.
And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Let's pray. God, we love you. Lord, we come to you right now in Jesus' name. Lord, we ask your hand to be upon us. I pray, God, you just help us, the Lord, to preach the message, God, in a way that you would be pleased. Lord, and I pray that the Holy Spirit would move through this building. God, touch hearts, touch individual hearts. God, if there's one that's not saved, Lord, I pray, God, you burden our hearts. God. And I pray for the Christian right now, God. Help us to realize, dear Lord, that well, we've got things going on in our life, dear God, that we can do better. I pray right now, Lord, you would just move in the church. And whatever's done, we'll praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. I want to preach a little while on the thought of why no room. Why no room? As I was thinking about this, you know, and I've come to the conclusion that people do what they want to do. They go where they want to go. And, you know, it's always been that way and it's not going to change. I'm just going to be honest with you. I can stand up here and preach. I'm blue in the face. Preacher Mike can get up here and preach. He's blue in the face. Preacher John can preach. He's blue in the face. These teachers can teach all they want to. But until you realize that you want to do better, you ain't going to do no better.
Amen.
Amen.
I can preach about church attendance, and until you realize you want to be in church, it ain't going to get no better. I'm just being honest with you. I thought about it. If the people at Bethlehem would have wanted to help, they could have helped. I found this little story. In the fall of 1775, the manager of Baltimore's largest hotel refused lodging to a man that was dressed as a farmer. The manager thought that his lowly appearance would discredit his inn. The man left and found room in another place. Shortly thereafter, the manager discovered that the man he had refused lodging was none other than Thomas Jefferson, then the Vice President of the United States. Immediately, he sent a note to Jefferson and invited him to return as his guest. Jefferson replied by instructing his messenger, "Tell him that I have already engaged a room. I value his intentions highly, but if he has no place for a dirty American farmer, then he has none for the Vice President of the United States." Why was there no room for Jesus? I found an old hymn. I had never heard this, so maybe some of you have heard this hymn. It goes, the title of it is No Room in the Inn. This is how it goes. No beautiful chamber, no soft bed, no place but a manger, nowhere for his head. No praises of gladness, no thought for their sin, no glory but sadness, no room in the inn. None to receive him, no welcome while here, no balm to relieve him, no staff but a spear. No seeking his treasure, no weeping for sin, none doing his pleasure, no room in the inn. And then the chorus goes like this. Now listen to this. No room, no room for Jesus. Oh, give him welcome free. Lest you should hear at heaven's gate, there is no room for thee. Why was there no room for Jesus? Why don't we have room for Jesus in our hearts now? And I'm preaching to people in this building. I'm not worried about getting that on the hill and on Brooklyn. I'm preaching to people in this building. Why don't we have room for Jesus? I want you to just look at just a few things and I'll let you go. Number one, there was no room because no one was expecting him. Understand something. They didn't have RSVP back then. You couldn't just get online and go to the Bethlehem Ramada and sign up and get a room. The Bible says, if you read this scripture, the Bible says that the whole world was being taxed and everybody had to go back to their home place so that they could sign up for this taxation or whatever. So the place was busy. It was bustling with people. It's sort of like today, you know, people running around and just all over the place and trying to do this and trying to do that. And if we ain't careful, we don't have room for Jesus because we're so busy with everything that's going on in our lives that we put Jesus away.
Amen.
Come on, preach.
It was busy about their own lives. All these people had come to be taxed and no one counted. What about the people that lived there, Preacher Mike? Not only the stranger. Now, there was no room in the inn. Understand something. An inn is for travelers. But this is where Joseph was from. He had family there, Timmy Henson. And still, Jesus was born in a stable. So we got to understand, if we ain't careful, we get so busy with our lives, we get so busy with everything going on with us that we neglect Jesus and we're worried about our own selfish care. I got my room, they can fend for themselves. I got my little spot. I'm looking out for me and my family. I'm looking out for what I need. I'm looking out for everything that I need. See, that's the problem with most people today. They've got their own little, I'm going to throw this out there. That's the problem with most churches. They've got their own little group, and they don't want nobody else. I mean, we got our few, and we don't want nobody else coming in here telling us how to live. We don't want nobody coming in here telling us how we're supposed to do things. We don't have room for Jesus because nobody really was expecting it, and we all looking out for self. How many times we could come to church, but we don't. Brother Jamie mentioned something he's tonight. It's kind of funny. Some preacher said, you might need to tell them we're going to stop doing live Facebook because some of them might come back to church. You can get a lot of amens right there.
Just come on, preach.
Well, I ain't got to go to church tonight. I can sit here and watch it on the computer. No room for Jesus. I got my own room. Let him get his own room. I got my family to take care of. Well, let me get, I'm gonna throw something at you. The Bible says in Leviticus, now y'all do realize that's Old Testament. Leviticus.
Amen.
Okay? This was a long time before Jesus' birth. Okay, y'all got this? Thou shalt not avenge nor bear any grudge against the children of thy people, but thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself.
Amen.
I am the Lord. See, a lot of people want to say, well, Jesus said that in the New Testament. No, Jesus wrote it in Leviticus.
Amen.
Love thy neighbor as thyself was a long time before the birth of Jesus. We're supposed to treat everybody with kindness. We're supposed to treat everybody with love. We're supposed to make sure we got room for everybody. How many of us have room for Jesus? Now, I want you to notice something else. Galatians chapter 5, verse 14 says this. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even this. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Now, if we're supposed to love our neighbor as ourselves, what are we supposed to do with Jesus? If we're supposed to love our neighbor as ourselves, don't you think we're supposed to have room for Jesus?
Amen.
It's real easy for me to love Preacher John. It's real easy for me to go the extra mile for Preacher John. When was the last time I went the extra mile for Jesus?
Amen.
It's real easy for me to love Wes and see we got folks that we'll do for. And Brother David was mentioning this in Sunday school this morning. How, you know, Greg will go the extra mile to help folks in the church. And we got a lot of folks in the church that go the extra mile to help folks in the church. But what about helping Jesus?
Wow.
There was no room for Jesus. That's what I'm preaching on. I'm not preaching about me helping Matthew or Matthew helping me. I'm talking about me making room for Jesus.
Amen.
Let me just do it. Think about this. That word room right there. Now listen, that word room right there, if you go back to the Greek verb, the Greek of that room, it means spot. You know what that means? That means these people would not even give one little spot to Jesus. Not one spot did they have, Brother Bill, not one place, not one spot did they have that they would let Jesus in. Why was there no room? Why ain't there no room at your house? Why don't we have room for Jesus? There was no room, maybe because it took longer than they expected. As I was reading this, and I've read this verse many times, and I thought about this, and it was so, verse 6, and it was so that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. We get it in our minds, if we're not careful, we get it in our minds that they got on the donkey, they left Nazareth, they go up to Bethlehem, she has the baby, everything the Bible says. But the Bible says that while they were there, the days were accomplished. In other words, if you read this just by the way it reads, that means they could have been there for several days. They could have been there for weeks. We don't know. Why does it take longer than expected? If we ain't careful, we overlook that. They should have been expecting him because the scripture said he was coming. The Bible says in Micah chapter 5, verse 2, "But thou, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall come forth unto me, that is to be a ruler in Israel, whose going forth have been told from old to everlasting." And they had people that knew. They had people that knew. The Bible says that the wise men knew. The Bible says that the wise men, verse 1 of Matthew chapter 2, "That when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east of Jerusalem, saying, Where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship." The wise men knew. The Bible tells us that the preachers or the priests knew about it. In Matthew chapter 2, when the king inquired, they said, "And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes and the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. And they said to him, In Bethlehem of Judea, for it is written by the prophets." The Bible was plain about his coming, so they should have been expecting him.
Amen.
No matter how long it took, they should have been expecting him. Now let's turn this around a little bit. There's no room for him today, because nobody's expecting it. Oh, preacher, I've heard that all my life. Ever since I was a child, I've heard that Jesus is coming. Oh, ever, you've been telling us that for 18 years, that Jesus is coming. Some of y'all in here, preacher, how old are you, preacher? Long as you can remember, you've been hearing Jesus is coming. Brother Don, how old are you?
84.
Long as you've been alive, you've been hearing Jesus is coming. Well, my professor says different. Your professor's a liar. My friend said, well, your friend's a liar.
Wow.
The Bible tells us in Matthew chapter 24, now listen, in Matthew chapter 24, "But as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark, and knew not until the flood came and took them all away, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be." There, now listen, I want you to understand, there's no room because he's taking longer than expected. But understand something, we ought to be able to see today. We ought to be able to look around today and see what's going on. Listen to this. There's never been a time in human history. You listen to me. There's never been a time in human history like we have right now that the mark of the beast could be implemented next week.
Amen.
Listen to some of the articles that's been written worldwide over the last few years. Sweden close to being a cashless society. Cash is dead. Our credit card's next. Nigeria deploying biometric technology throughout the banking system. MasterCard tracking global economics heading for a cashless society. Israel's leaders pushing for a cashless society. All these are articles that have been written over the world in the last few years. The UN World Food Program pushing smart cards and digital payment. Cashless society drive gaining momentum in Rwanda. Now, not so we can see the time. You ought to be expecting it.
Right.
What are some of the other things that happened? U.S. Supreme Court declares gay marriage legal, an historic decision. You ought to be expecting Jesus. Right now, there are currently 110 million cases of sexually transmitted diseases, with 20 million new cases every year in America alone. You ought to be expecting Jesus. What about natural disasters? Just look at what we had happen this year. I mean, hurricanes breaking record after record after record. First year in history that we've had, what, three category four or five hurricanes ever? You ought to be expecting him.
Amen.
You better make room. Because he's coming.
Amen.
Why ain't you expecting him? People are too busy with their own life. I got my thing going on, preacher. I'll get saved. I'm going to get right with God. I'm going to do what's right. When? When it's too late? Why is there no room? The scripture tells us he's coming.
Yes, he does.
Hey, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 says, but I will not have you to be ignorant. You know what that means? He's telling you, I'll give you every detail. I'll give you all the signs. I'll give you my word. You ought to be able to see it's coming. There's not going to be one person, Brother Tony, that when the rapture takes place will be able to stand before God and say, you didn't tell me about it.
Amen.
You'll say, depart from me. I know you not. I would not have you to be ignorant. Unlearned about my coming. That's what he's saying. Concerning them which are asleep and sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and I do, glory to God, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. So shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. He's coming. He's coming. Why don't you have room for it? You know, Matt, if we don't make room for him, he ain't going to make room for you.
Amen.
Preacher, I just don't understand how busy my life is. You don't understand what I'm talking about.
Amen.
Listen, there ain't no gray areas. You're either saved or lost. There ain't no in-betweens, and there ain't no limitations. You can't straddle the fence, amen. There ain't no straddling the fence. You're either saved or lost.
Amen.
Jesus is coming. Jesus is coming. No room. Let me read you one more illustration, and then I'm gonna have the invitation. Not long ago, a professor of psychology in one of the big universities gave a word suggestion test to his class of 40 students. Now listen to this. He instructed them to write the word Christmas. And all the class did so. Now, said the professor, right after the word Christmas, the first thought that flashes through your mind regarding that day. When the papers were turned in, such answers were given as a tree, holly, mistletoe, presents, turkey, holidays, carols, Santa Claus, but not one word was mentioned of Jesus' birthday. That goes to prove right there that we don't have room for Jesus.
Amen.
We worry more about trees than we are about Jesus. We worry more about presents than we are about Jesus. We worry more about getting together with family. And ain't nothing wrong with all these things. I understand that all these things are great in their place. But if Jesus is not number one, you're wasting your time with the rest of us. If Jesus is not number one, we're just going to say this. He will not be number two.
Amen.
Amen.
Do you understand that? What are you saying, preacher? It is what it is. Thou shalt have no other gods before me.
Amen.
God's telling you right there, I'm not going to be number two. I will not be second place in your life. So you either got to have Jesus number one, or when the rapture takes place, guess what? You're going to be in trouble. No room. No room. Matt, can you sing "You Walk"? Every mile we pray. Everything Jesus did, and I made mention of this last week, and Brother Scooby kind of made mention of this on the, just sitting kind of on the front row all day. You do realize when Jesus was in the cradle, he was still God.
Amen.
There's never been a time that he ceased to be God. Not one instance did he ever cease not to be God. From the cradle, now listen, from the cradle, and I thought about building a message on this, but from the cradle, he directed the heavenly choir that sang about his birth and told about his birth. From the cradle, he's the one that let the stars rise down. From the cradle, he already knew he was going to die on the cross to save souls. Jesus loves you, and Jesus still loves you today. And Jesus, he said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. And I go to prepare a place for you. What he's saying right there, Tony, if you'll make room for me, I'll make room for you.
Amen.
But if you don't make room for me, guess what? Might not be a room for you. God, we love you. God, we realize and we know that, Lord, from the cradle to the cross, God, all the way to the grave, that you love us. God, I ask your hand to be upon us right now, God. Lord, I pray, God, you would move in this church. I pray that the Holy Spirit would just speak to hearts. God, I pray, God, you would help people to realize, your God, Lord, that you're not going to be number two in nobody's life. God, I pray right now, Lord, you help us, the Lord, to make sure that you're number one in our lives, God. I pray, Lord, you just touch hearts. Lord, if there's somebody here today and they're not saved, God, help them to get on this altar before it's too late. And whatever's done, we're going to praise you. We're going to honor you, God, because you're worthy in Jesus' name. Amen. If you would, let's stand. Maybe you've been letting other things crowd out Jesus. Maybe you've been letting other things take the place of Jesus. Won't you come? Won't you come? Is he number one? Is he number one?
I remember all the time.
folks want to say it started in the cradle, but it didn't. Bible says that plan was made out a long time before God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit ever got together and spoke everything into existence. There's never been a time. Listen, what? There's never been a time that Jesus didn't love you. Please make room for Jesus. And let me say this. When you make room for Jesus, keep room for Jesus. It's real easy for things to happen in our lives. We get faithful for a few weeks and then we fall right back out. Keep room for Jesus. Amen. I love you. Don't forget about service tonight.